from the Subaru of Gwinnett Studio, welcome to Celebrating Powerhouse Women. Celebrating Powerhouse Women is proudly presented by NEMA and Sourced.
And hello again, everybody, and welcome back to another exciting episode of Celebrating Powerhouse Women. I am your host, Amanda Pierce Marmalejo, and today I am joined in studio by a powerhouse herself, Miss Hilda Abbott. Good morning, Hilda.
Good morning, Amanda. Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Hilda, she owns a successful company here in Gwinnett County. It is called RudHil, and she is the founder and CEO. Recently, you might have caught her during the Glow series. She was one of the esteemed speakers on the panel. I unfortunately did not get to catch that, but I heard great things, Hilda. Mm-hmm. Share with our listeners a little bit about your company if they are unfamiliar with what you do in the county.
Well, RudHil Companies was founded back in September of 2021. I come from a background of over 23 years in the real estate industry. It's very unique. Our company is, everything is centered around real estate, but it's very diverse in what real estate is. So we practice what is residential real estate, commercial real estate, investment, education in real estate, mentoring and real estate, as well as bringing in nonprofits as well. So it's a very interesting company. I'm very proud of our team and the success that we've had thus far. And we're just looking to expand and grow and teach our community what real estate really means.
You know, the term real estate is largely misconstrued and it encompasses a lot of things. You and I were speaking before the show about your passion to kind of pour into what you do and the unique culture that your company breeds. Mm-hmm. Share a little bit about some of the initiatives that you guys have going on within RudHil mm-hmm. that you look to kind of, gain some exposure mm-hmm. through.
So we formed a nonprofit called RudHil Cares. And with RudHil Cares, it is two facets of it. We have the first phase, which is to help elderly and disabled homeowners that may be at the brink of having to sell their home or lose their homes based on repairs because the taxes have gone up. They're on a strict fixed income and cannot fix their roof, fix a bathroom, or they need to change their tub to be a shower. They're getting older, and RudHil Cares will come in and do those repairs for them so that way then they could keep being in their home. The second part of it is Fire Lab, which is Future Youth Real Estate Lab. And that is helping our youth understand what real estate really means, which is an investment. So instead of thinking about investment in an IRA, investing in the stock market, this is a very good way to create generational wealth if you treat it properly and you know what you're doing with experts leading the way. So those are two of the initiatives that we have going on that I'm very proud of.
That's very exciting. Oftentimes people don't really think of, like what you mentioned with RudHil Cares, as you age and need some ADA modifications mm-hmm. made or things like that. That's wonderful that you're able to work with those homeowners. Mm-hmm. Do you have a subcontracting team that works for you, like general contractors that go in and do those repairs, or do you outsource that piece?
Well, that comes from the part of my husband's company. He has a construction and remodeling company, and actually that's where the concept came from. They were at a job site and had to go get some materials at Home Depot. And one of the gentlemen, which is Rudy's construction manager, stopped by the plumbing area and saw this elderly woman, probably in her late 70s, looking for some parts. So he asked, he's like, well, how can I help you? I mean, she just looked very distraught, mm-hmm. didn't know what she was looking for. And she told him, well, my sink is leaking and the plumber wants to charge me $700 to mm-hmm. fix it. I just want to see what I could do. I don't have the money. So long story short, he bought the piece that it was, and he actually came back and said, I think you're going to be upset, but I think you're going to be excited as well. He went to their house, and it took them half an hour and $20 to fix this repair that this other contractor was going to charge her $700 for. So that's where the concept of RudHil Cares through helping the elderly and disabled came about.
Wow. gosh, I hate that. Mm-hmm. I hate that people are taken advantage of like that. And that's mm-hmm. amazing that you and your husband both share that passion for giving back. Mm-hmm. Now, the name of your company, I'm going to kind of put you on the spot because your husband's name is Rudy, right?
Yes, it is.
And that's kind of like, if I'm just looking at RudHil, share with us a little bit about the concept behind the name of your company.
Well, the name of RudHil, if I don't have children, and if I was to have a daughter, her name would have been RudHil Abbott. Ooh. But RudHil was taken already. That name was taken for the company. Mm. So we added the D, and then it was RudHil, mm-hmm. Rudy and Hilda. But actually, RudHil means the R is real estate, the U is United Investments, the D is development, H is home inspection, I is insurance, and L is legal and lending services. So the name encompassed what we wanted to do with the company when it was created, and it just came about as a flow. But the actual name came as RudHil without the D. Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's so nice. Wait a minute. Okay, rewind. And then we'll get off of RudHil, but it's just so exciting unpacking it. So all of the things that you just mentioned, real estate, development, homeowners, home insurance, legal lending, all that, you are able to provide all of those services within your organization?
Once the RudHil Companies is formed, uh-huh. it will be RudHil Real Estate, RudHil United Investments, RudHil Development. So all these six companies will encompass RudHil Companies wow. as a whole. We already started with the R, which is the real estate part.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's so exciting, Hilda. Holy smokes. You're gonna have a lot to keep you busy.
Yeah, a lot to keep me busy, but I have very good people within our team and our executive team that believe in this vision and seeing that working together and bringing everything together as the real estate hub will be beneficial for the clients at the end of the day when they're looking for real estate services. All these six components come in to one transaction. Mm-hmm. So having the right team behind you for either a purchase of your own personal primary residence or for an investment, or if you're looking for a space to lease or to buy, having the right team together, working together, it makes the system much smoother.
Yeah, more fluid, having mm-hmm. all in one place, the resources, rather than having to, this is my mm-hmm. that person, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. Really quickly, to kind of bring it full circle, as we are seated here with a company of a very handsome gentleman named Alex, I'm going to call you out. Oh, I'm sorry, and our producer, Mike. two handsome gentlemen, shall I say. I have had the opportunity to spend some time with you guys over the past few years, and you guys have a very unique culture that you kind of breed across your organization. So share with our listeners a little bit about the in-house culture of RudHil and what is important to you as far as mission and values.
Mm-hmm. Well, for me, our saying is real estate plus community inclusion equals empowerment. And by that is bringing everyone together at the same table, regardless of what position you're in. And I've been very fortunate to hold executive positions, even if they were not companies that I formed, but also I've been partner in another company prior to RudHil. So the culture for me is having the right team and that everyone is invaluable to the organization. And I think that a lot of leaders do miss that point. Well, they're my staff, I have to pay them, or if they don't want to come to work, I could find someone else. But that actually puts back the momentum, especially on a growing company, that everyone is so important in within all of us. So I've been very fortunate of having people like Alex and Albert and Narsuli and Angelica and Joyce. I mean, all these plus mentors that have come together believing in the same mission. And that's why I think our growth has been more than what we have expected for the short amount of time.
I'd say that too. You know, I'm able just to observe you guys through social media and within the community, and you guys are definitely a united force, and you're making an impact. So I look forward to seeing your growth and success as
Thank you.
The years continue. Let's just kind of rewind the clock a little bit and get to know personally a little bit about you, Hilda. Mm-hmm. Share with us a little bit about where you grew up, how you made it here to Gwinnett County, and kind of fill in some blanks for us.
Well, I've been living in Gwinnett County. Well, Georgia, I've only lived in Gwinnett County, but for 13 years now. prior to that, I was raised in Miami, but I was born in Texas. So my mom and my dad are of Dominican Republic descent. Don't ask me what they were doing in Texas, because that's not one of the states that people from the Dominican migrate to. But that's where I was born, and then I was raised in Miami. So we moved here to Georgia. My husband is a mechanical engineer, and he actually won a bid to do a subdivision where all the HVAC units, that was in Bethlehem.
Oh, wow.
So it was supposed to be a 6 to 10 month project, and here we are now. So after it was completed, we just loved it, and we stayed living here.
Mm-hmm. So 13 years here in Georgia. Mm-hmm. What, you said that you have a long tenure in real estate yourself. Mm-hmm. So kind of take us through that career path. Like, what inspired you to get into the world of real estate? When you acquired your license, is it at all like the process is today?
Mm-hmm. Well, it was the exam was paper and pencil.
Fill in the bubbles, yeah. And it was proctored.
It was at that time. I started in what now it's called the bottom feet of real estate, which is apartment leasing. And I was getting paid $10 an hour and $50 per new lease and $25 for renewals. And I attribute that, the compassion that I have now and what I learned so much about people and the different stages in life, I do attribute it to starting off in the apartment industry, multifamily. So from there, I started as leasing. I became assistant manager, property manager, senior property manager. Most of my career, probably 15 years of my career, I spent in the multifamily sector. But after I did leasing, we did acquisitions, also disposition, working with investments, REO properties with the big banks, BOA, Wells, BB&T at that point. But that was probably when I was 15 years into my career, I started doing the multi-level 500, 700 units acquisition, bringing in a team, getting the properties up to speed, mm-hmm. rent them out, lease out, and then an investor will come and buy a solid portfolio. So
wow.
From there, I didn't do much of the residential sales here or there. I did for my family, but most of it has been in the commercial sector, multifamily, or large portfolios.
Wow. That's funny when you're talking about acquisitions. I had a small hand in an acquisition of a hotel once upon a time, and we mm-hmm. had to execute a PIP, mm-hmm. property improvement plan. Mm-hmm. So when you were saying that, mm-hmm. I was like, I wonder if that's a PIP.
Mm-hmm.
I will say you probably did. You say cut your teeth at the bottom level there. $10 an hour, man, with a $50 commission. That's really, you're having to stack those dollars and dimes. But mm-hmm. I really do love how you said that that's why you have such an appreciation mm-hmm. and so much compassion. I can only imagine the scenarios that you've seen in leasing and things like mm-hmm. that. But getting back to your passion for real estate, did you just wake up one day and you said, hey, you know, this looks like it could be lucrative, or I'm going to do this until I figure out what I'm going to do? Or did you know that it's something that you wanted to pursue lifelong?
Well, I think since I was little, I've loved real estate. My family has always owned the property we have lived in. It's something that my dad instilled in us, that you buy your property, you could paint it. Look, we had at several of our homes, we moved probably 3 times throughout me growing up. He would put our name on the concrete.
Aww.
When they would pour the concrete of me and my siblings. And he would say, you see, you wouldn't be able to do this if you didn't own this property. So I've always had that in me of home ownership and what it meant, and how happy we grew up. We had the same friends. Most of our friends were also, you know, homeowners as well down the street. So we built a very close knit. And I saw that because of real estate, we didn't have to keep moving from place to place, or people asking us to move, or we couldn't afford it. This was our home, and it was something that was very instilled in me since I was little.
Pride of ownership mm-hmm. is what I'm hearing. Now, I do have to ask, I'm sure you own your home now with your husband.
Yes.
Did you write your name in the concrete?
I did not.
We're going to need to pour a sidewalk extension so you guys can write your name.
I did not, no. We have the paws of the dogs, of two of them, because when we moved to our home we are currently living in, we only had two, and since then we've acquired two more.
Aw, you're a fur mom. Mm-hmm. That's very exciting. You shared a little bit about your siblings and your father, and you were speaking very endearingly of him. Tell us a little bit about your family, like what it was like growing up, how many siblings you have, and maybe about the relationship with your dad that has mm-hmm. impacted you so greatly.
My dad is one of the best men I know. I've been very fortunate at having good men around me. I've been with my husband for 24 years. I know you've seen Alex with me of years. I mean, he's family. He's my brother. My dad is an amazing man. I have four other brothers. We get along very well, and one sister. And we used to hang out a lot and ruffle a lot. I am the third oldest of the six, so.
Mm-hmm. Large family.
Yeah.
But you yourself, if I may, are you're only a dog mom. So do you, sometimes when people grow up in large families, they want to reproduce large families, or like they want to run in
yes.
the opposite other direction.
Yes.
So is that kind of the turn that you guys took? You'd rather apply yourself to the world and mm-hmm. your community and your companies?
Mm-hmm. I'm married young and going to school and pursuing my career, and my husband as well. When we kind of realized, well, are we going to have kids? I was like, well, at this point, we already have a very established way that we operate. We want to, you know, pack a bag and go for a weekend. Yeah. We're able to do so. We live very freely. We sleep in if we want to. We don't have all those responsibilities that I think it was going to be something that was going to change our life, and we didn't want it to be hindering per se, that mm-hmm. well, now this kid is coming and it's messing up our lives, right? Okay. So at that point, we just decided not to have any kids.
Mm-hmm. I can empathize with that. Only here very recently has my purview changed a little bit, but I too myself, for those very reasons, pursued my career mm-hmm. Rather than building a family. Share with us your cute meet story about how you and Rudy met, because you guys have been together for so long. So
Rudy and I met in the Dominican Republic. I was living in Miami. He lived in New York, and we were both on vacation. And we met at a beauty salon my mom used to own. So I had graduated high school, and I was actually going to go to medical school in the Dominican. My dad was very proud. He said when COVID, I'm just jumping one. He's like, if you would have been a doctor, you probably would have been working at the CDC and helped. I said, well, it's my fault that COVID happened, Dad. Yes, that's why, because I'm not a doctor and that happened. But anyway,
you can prevent it.
Yes, I could have prevented all that. But I met Rudy because I went for once I graduated high school that summer, I went to spend with my mom, and she owned a beauty salon with my aunt. So it was, you know, my cousins, and it was just a good thing. And Rudy came actually to the beauty salon to get his nails done. Ooh. And guess how he got there? Because we were doing marketing. So he said, your marketing and your flyers and your promotions work. So my cousin and I went through the whole strip. It was very known place in the capital, Santo Domingo, and El Malecón. And then they have all the 5-star hotels down that strip. And my cousin and I went and did some flyers and said, well, if anyone's asking, 20%, you know, 20% discount, and we'll give you a referral fee. So that's how Rudy came. He's like, your marketing worked. You caught me as a client. So since then, we've been inseparable.
Oh, and hey, you can already tell the caliber of man if he's coming in for a nice manicure.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
Hey, and to this day, you're still doing effective marketing.
Marketing. he said he's going to give me a testimonial that marketing does work when you do it at certain levels. So
just crazy question, is the salon still in existence?
No, mom sold it.
Dissolved mm-hmm. it, yeah. Mm-hmm. So it would seem entrepreneurship is something that runs in your family. So would you say that kind of observing maybe her owning the salon and the grit that your father had, and, you know, kind of watching her build a business, is kind of where you got some of your chuspah mm-hmm. in order to build the empire that you've built today?
Mm-hmm. It has been. I've seen they very hardworking. My grandmother as well, coming from an immigrant country, here trying to navigate, learn the language. How can they make it work with their talents and the education that they brought from the Dominican was something that they instilled with us since very little. My mom made us read in English and Spanish. Mm-hmm. So we are bilingual. We learned both languages at the same time. It wasn't because being bilingual, you're able to, you know, conquer both markets. It was mostly, this is your legacy. This is your generation. You must communicate with your grandmother, your grandfather, your aunts and uncles that live back in the Dominican and do not speak English. So she was very, a very tough mom. But now I see it as something that the way that she raised us was in a very good manner for the success that I could attribute that I have now.
Absolutely. And you exude those qualities. For those of you just joining us, my guest today is Hilda Abbott, and we're going to take a quick break for a word from our sponsors. And when we come back, we will dive back in.
NEMA is a full-service logistics company that provides trucking, warehousing, and expedited deliveries for the paper machine clothing industry. They offer a full line of services, including delivery within the 48 contiguous states, Canada, and Mexico, plus importing and exporting, air freight forwarding services, foreign trade zone warehousing, and many more services to handle your global logistics needs. NEMA is a proud sponsor of the Celebrating Powerhouse Women podcast series.
We know running a business is hard. There are so many things that need to get done, and you don't have the time, the resources, the experience, or you just don't want to do it yourself. At Sourced, we have your back. Office. We support leaders of companies with all their back office challenges that weigh them down, whether it's accounting, talent acquisition, administrative support, marketing, or human resources. Our team of experts at Sourced will make your life easy and your back office effortless. To see how we can help you, check us out at getsourced.com.
All right, and welcome back to Celebrating Powerhouse Women. I am your host, Amanda Pierce Marmolejo. Can you say my last name for me, Hilda?
Marmolejos.
Marmolejo. Man, if only I could. Marmolejo. It sounds so beautiful coming out of your mouth. Mom, please don't kill me, okay? I was mentioning to you, much like you, my mother is a first-generation immigrant. Mm-hmm. She is from Argentina. And unlike you, my father is American. So Spanish wasn't spoken in my household. And that is one of my biggest regrets, that I did not have the tenacity, like you were mentioning, in order to grasp the language. Mine is just bits and pieces. And yes, I can apply myself at age 36 and learn. And I think that's something that is in my future. Mm-hmm. Because much like you were mentioning about your grandparents, I fear, as English is my mother's second language, mm-hmm. that should something happen to her memory down the road, mm-hmm. that she's going to revert back to Spanish, and that's going to be the only language to communicate. Mm-hmm. So I need to really tighten up the strap. Mm-hmm. So maybe we can practicar mucho.
Yes, we can.
Okay, very nice. I would like to know, as a powerhouse woman here, excuse me, I know that you cover like all of Georgia, and probably not even just Georgia. You do business outside of the state of Georgia?
Not at the present time, just Georgia.
You have quite a name for yourself here in Gwinnett County. I mentioned earlier that you were just recently featured as one of the GLOW speakers, and I know that you're a great participant within the Chamber of Commerce. Alex actually just came back from Dubai with the Chamber. That's exciting. Mm-hmm. Share a little bit about the importance of being involved within your community, the power of networking, and also being a positive influence or role model for those within the community, being on stage like at the GLOW event or things like that at the Moxies.
For me, it's something that when you share your story, and you see, even with different ethnicities, I really, really enjoyed the GLOW panel, because we were from different walks of life, different ages, different ethnicity, and coming together and seeing the struggles that it takes women in leadership is something very amazing and unique. So being involved in the different chambers and in the different organizations and hearing what we go through as women that want to excel in our careers, whether it be in an executive corporate position or it be forming your own company, having that group, a network of people that are available to help you with the information that you need is detrimental if you don't work with the right network and get together with that.
What does a good leader mean to you? What does being a good leader mean to you?
A good leader is a leader that works in partnership with their team. it just because you have that title of being the leader or the owner of the company does not make you better piece of the pie. Everyone that is part of a team is there for a reason. And being a good leader for me is giving everyone the same voice. If you're part of this organization, obviously you want the organization to thrive. So your opinion is very important to bring it to the table if there are changes that some leaders do not like to listen to opinions. This is the way that I see my company going. Your opinion doesn't matter. It's my money. It's my stress. If the company fails, as a leader, you're one to tank as well. Mm-hmm. But there are, if you do have people within your team, you have to think back, why did you bring them into the room, into the table? And acquiring the information from the people that are around you that have the best interest for the company, for me, is what makes a good leader.
I like that. Mm-hmm. Throughout your career, or just life as a whole, who would you say has been paramount in your growth? Maybe someone that has been a positive influence or role model, if you can say that, a mentor per se. Who is somebody who's been influential in your success?
First person would be my husband.
I knew you were going to say that, yeah. Mm-hmm.
He has been my biggest cheerleader. I don't know if he said, he knows how to say no to me, or if I would even listen to him saying no. But he, every idea I have, whether it's the oddest idea, the craziest, or the most brilliant, he cheers me on. He says, I know that what you're doing is for longevity. And when you put something together, it is because you know it's going to work and it's going to impact others. So that experience of him giving me that support has been fundamental for me personally and professionally.
Aw, shout out to Rudy. Mm-hmm. And then we'll reverse the question. Who have you had the opportunity to kind of take under your wing over the years, maybe through the growth of your company or just life as a whole, that you know that you have positively impacted?
I think the young girls. I've had my nieces work with me, and I have someone that's actually with me at RudHil that started working with me when she was 20, and we just celebrated her 29th birthday this week. And seeing that growth, she was a child. Now she has a family, bought her own property, is doing so well, and followed me throughout my career. Previous, when I was with We Partner, another company, coming with me, that I feel that I did a very good impact for her. Mm-hmm. I have my niece that also works with me, and she's been with me for 6 years. So I think that I've made more of a bigger impact on the youth, that they see it. But I've heard from others that some things that I've said or classes that I've taught have actually shifted the way that they thought about a certain process. So.
And that's the most remarkable part, because you've probably touched and influenced so many more people than you actually know. Mm-hmm. And that's very exciting. I'm curious, because you're so well poised and you're so, you know, just involved, what you do in order to remain, I hate using the word balance, work-life integration, shall I say, there's no balance. What do you like to do for fun? What do you do outside of the office that kind of keeps you whole?
I read a lot. But it's mostly about real estate and planning and different things. I mean, I can't stress enough about teamwork and leadership, because my folks, either they love me or they just don't tell me that I'm doing anything wrong. I research a lot. I send them things at 1 and 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, I apologize, but I just thought this was amazing. Mm-hmm. I love to have good food. Mm-hmm. I love having great conversations, dancing, mm-hmm. wine, mm-hmm. travel. I guess it's a massages. I guess mm-hmm. a lot that women like to do. Mm-hmm. But I don't have such a hobby per se. I don't have a hobby that calms me down. It's more on the reading and research that, you know, that's my solace. I take a day and I want to read about things, and that kind of balances me out.
Good for you. Mm-hmm. I don't think I have a hobby either. I'm interested to hear you said hobby. I was like, oh, yeah, I don't like play tennis or anything like that. So I don't know. I'm very curious. You kind of breezed over it and we don't have to dive too far into it. But you mentioned another company we partner. And I don't want to spend too much time on what that company is. My interest is more in how you launched RudHil after that chapter closed, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. So you helped launch that company, you made it successful and thriving, and then you turned in a different direction and you launched and now have another successful company. What are some obstacles that you had to overcome or some challenges kind of in that transition that helped make you stronger with RudHil now?
Mm-hmm. Well, with the previous company, I was one of the founders. It was two other partners, both women. And when COVID hit is where everything shifted. The world is going to end. Everyone was in panic mode. What are we going to do? So we started liquidating assets. And the easiest one that came to mind to us as founders of the company was to sell the residential component. And mostly work here in the Gwinnett area. And I started working with Hispanic realtors on a one-on-one. When I saw the problems that these contracts were coming to me, I mean, clients from day one losing $10,000, no due diligence, I mean, just really bad information. I started negotiating with the agents. I'm like, are you sure you want? I mean, if it would have been another listing or seller, mm-hmm. we would have made a lot of money. From people from day one. Mm-hmm. And I started teaching the agents, well, what about this? Wouldn't this be better? So I played kind of both sides, educating these realtors, which in turn now some of them are with me in RudHil. Mm-hmm. So I spoke to my partners. I said, listen, we're selling this. I think we have to build another division. And that's where the realty component came in. And I moved from chief operating officer of the mother company to president and qualifying broker of the realty component. It just so happened that being a Hispanic broker, most of the agents that were coming to the realty were Hispanic women. So it was a bit debate. Is it a Hispanic company? Is it a corporate company? Is it a 1099? Is it a staff? Is it independent contractors? So I broke off. I first stepped down as chief operating officer and just stayed with the brokerage component of that company. And after it just started growing and expanding and bringing in more awareness of the Hispanic community, I just saw that it needed its own light because the brands were not matching. Mm. So the brand of the mother company, which was the group, that in what it was turning into on the brokerage side were very different. Mm. So that's where the decision came of me being away from that company and opening up RudHil Company. It just needed its own light. It was nothing planned on either part. Mm-hmm. We thought it was an excellent idea to open up this the brokerage arm of the company. And in turn, then I lost partners. I mean, I just don't know how else to put it, but we're still very good friends. It ended up very cordial. It just turned into something that needed its own name mm-hmm. and its own light. Because the other company was a corporate company. Brokerage firms are all independent contractors. You run it as you want. You could have classes, you do Zoom, no one has to report to you. The broker is only involved in the sense of helping you be in compliance and making sure that all parties are in agreeance and all paperwork. But the other company were more corporate, 9 to 5:30. So there was a bit of imbalance. And I feel very fortunate that it happened that way. It was very organic. It was not malicious intent on any part, but it just formed into something else. So,
well, congratulations to you for having the foresight and seeing, you know, a different path and then gassing it mm-hmm. and going for it. Mm-hmm. That brings me to my next thought. You and I were talking a little bit about your commercial real estate division within RudHil, and I want to give you the opportunity to kind of expand on that.
In the Hispanic commercial arena, we had a panel last year in October for the first time ever in Georgia of full-time Hispanic commercial realtors in the state. There are actually 13 in the whole state that practice full-time commercial real estate that are Hispanic. And we are opening up now the commercial division at RudHil. It's RudHil Commercial, to bring in the education and awareness to our community that they are people that do speak their language, to help you open up and educate you how to lease a space, how to buy, prepare you with access to capital, and also within your term that you are leasing, preparing you to buy within the next 3 or 5 years. So the chambers are going to play a big part of this, and the Latin American Association, Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, Gwinnett Chamber of Commerce, Invest Atlanta, because I want to bring awareness that there are people like me, right, that can help you in your language. But it is so rare that what we're forming, I mean, in our company, we have two, and both of us are women. Mm-hmm. So that's even not even Hispanic commercial real estate. Woman Hispanic in commercial real estate is very rare.
Triple threat.
Mm-hmm. So we're trying to educate some of our residential agents that are more senior, that want to explore being into the commercial arena, and we are willing to do education seminar and bring mentees into it, because our Hispanic community is one of the fastest growing. And opening up business, being entrepreneurs, and having all these amazing ideas. So not having the right representation in your language is very upsetting to me. And that fuels my fire in opening up and having all these ideas of all this craziness, beautiful mess that we have going on at RudHil.
I love mm-hmm. It is a blender. Mm-hmm. Wow, I'm just blown away. I can imagine that you've helped people gain a lot of knowledge, and you've been able to help pair them with the right properties or the right resources. Mm-hmm. I know that right now some industries are really experiencing a hiccup in the workforce development arena. Mm-hmm. How are you in your world preparing the next generation to kind of, you know, jump into what you do? You mentioned the fire lab mm-hmm. and things like that. Are you able to find young budding realtors who want to be a part of, I'm going to call it a RudHil movement, mm-hmm. that you're able to kind of position, you know, for future success? Some companies, manufacturers can't even find, you know, people to work. Mm-hmm. So 10 years from now, when the boomers retire, there's not going to be a workforce in place. Are you experiencing anything like that? And if so, how are you preparing to fill that void with new agents?
Mm-hmm. Well, we have within our team, we have agents that are younger, that have worked with me before. I mentioned a couple of the young ladies, and they are actually helping me develop and work with the Fire Lab. Well, but the Fire Lab is not only to become realtors. It is mostly on the education component, how to treat real estate. From there, if the kids is between 16 and 21, if any of them are enticed in learning about real estate, we then teach them, send them to school, but it's not as a recruiting method. We just want it to be organically, and that the agents and the new generation that is coming after us do have the same passion and understand what this means for their generations and wealth, how to build wealth with your property where you lay your head at night. So those are the concepts that we're working with the younger generations, but it's mostly to teach them on how to protect themselves. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I will say I rented when I moved to Gwinnett 6 years ago, obviously I just had to rent, and my apartment rent was there's a $200 difference between my mortgage now and what I was paying for my apartment. Mm-hmm. And I did it because I was in transition, always knowing that home ownership would be the ultimate goal. But I just look back at those 5 years as a renter and just mm-hmm. you know how much money I just mm-hmm. which could have been going towards, you know, owning something like that you mentioned. So talk a little bit about how you prepare people for the investment side. Let's say I purchased my home, and I do intend within the next 3 years to retain it as a rental property. Mm-hmm. What is like the best path in order to execute something like that for someone that has no idea what they're doing?
Well, it depends on what type of investment you want to do. There's the HELOC. A lot of people talk about HELOC. It's home equity line of credit, where they give you a certain amount based on the equity of your property. And you don't have to use all those funds, but you could use up to a certain amount to then give as down payment for the investment property. When interest rates are low, the best way to cash out is it's kind of a cash out refi. So you refinance your home with a new institution, lower down your interest rate, get a certain amount of funds, and then invest it in another property. So it just depends on where the market is on interest rate right now. HELOC loans are better than refi. Interest rates are higher. HELOC loans are based on mostly on who you bank with. Mm-hmm. So their interests are lower than just a regular refinance.
Ooh, exciting. I might have to pick your brain about that.
We have some classes. I'll send you a calendar.
I would love that. Thank you very much. Yes. Much like you, I absorb knowledge just like a sponge and I crave it. So like you were saying in your downtime, you like to expand your mind. Mm-hmm. I too like to do the same thing. That's what podcasts are great for. Mm-hmm. Hilda, I could pick your brain about this all day long. I do just want to ask if you have any words of wisdom or any final thoughts that you could leave with our listeners, because I know that they would find a lot of value in maybe something that you have to offer from your experience.
As business women, getting involved with the different organizations such as the different Chamber of Commerce, different Women Council, it is very important for the growth of leadership, especially if you want to go into leadership roles in corporations or leadership roles within your org, you want to form your organization. Mentoring is a big factor. I cannot stress that enough. I have spent a lot of money or invested a lot of money in mentoring and coaching. And when I see people wanting to do it on their own and having to reinvent the wheel when there are people there that have been successful in doing it, mentoring and coaching is very an important factor for the growth of any young professional. And third is keep getting educated. It's not only getting educated on the field that you are going to be working in, learning about different cultures and learning about different industries that could probably blend into in the future. You could be doing something right now, but then you find interest in something else. If you want to jump from one industry to the other, having the right knowledge is what's going to set you apart.
I love that, Hilda. Thank you so much for sharing. And for those listening out there who are curious about RudHil and all the offerings, where can they find you online?
Our website is www.RudHil.com. And we are on all the social media, RudHil Co. Mm-hmm. Our office is located at 3675 Crestwood Parkway, Suite 120 here in Duluth. We're right next door. We're neighbors. And we are on all social media. Our phone number is 678-878-3888. And we do a lot of free educational financial seminars. If anyone is interested in giving us a call, find out when our next classes are, not only on home ownership, on how to become a realtor, but also on investment and scaling your company as well and your business.
I think I will be in attendance to some of those in the near future. Mm-hmm. Hilda, thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your very powerful story. I wish you and RudHil the best of success here in the years to come. I know that wonderful things await you. Alex, thank you for riding in the catbird seat. For our producer, Mike, this has been Celebrating Powerhouse Women on Business Radio X. I am Amanda Marmolejo. Please subscribe wherever you enjoy your podcast. They are available 24/7 online at businessradiox.com. And until next time.
Thank you.